Good evening, fellow admirers of great literature. Congratulations to you for being here. There are always dozens of wonderful things going on in our city on any given night, but this is the place to be tonight. In his beautiful essay in Sunday's New York Times Magazine, Francisco Goldman refers to his literary hero as possibly the most famous and generally beloved literary writer on earth. Well, it gives me mucho gusto to welcome you to a celebration of this beloved writer, and I do so on behalf of Pen American Center, its Board of Trustees, its Executive Director, Michael Roberts, and his gifted, hardworking staff. I'm Joel Conarroe, President of Pen American Center, and I'm particularly glad for a personal reason to have a small part in this ceremony. Some 25 years ago, I was chairman of a jury which awarded the very first Commonwealth Prize in literature to Gabriel García Márquez, well before his Nobel Prize. It was a scandalous time in America because he was unable to come to the country to accept the award, but even had he done so, well, it is unlikely he would have done so because he prefers to stand apart from honors and public ceremonies. I want to express our heartfelt thanks to those who have helped make this evening possible, our co-sponsors, Alfred A. Knopf and El Diario newspaper, and special thanks to the Kaplan Foundation and to our dear friend Lex Kaplan, who among other things designed the beautiful flyer, which of course is a keeper. There are a number of other friends to whom we're deeply indebted, and they are listed on the back of your program. We thank them most heartily. Well, since I'm in a name-dropping role, let me try a few more. Arthur Miller, Samuel Beckett, Franz Kafka, Flannery O'Connor, Langston Hughes, Gertrude Stein, Pablo Neruda, John Steinbeck. These are some of the great authors who have been honored at Pen American Center events. And it is a particular pleasure to add the name of Gabriel García Márquez to this distinguished list. We will hear from a starry panel of his admirers who will introduce themselves and who are described briefly in your program. The curator of tonight's festival is the chairman of Penn's Translation Committee, Esther Allen, a prize-winning translator. I salute her. Well, I'm glad you admire Esther as much as I do. She's quite wonderful. I salute her fellow panelists. And now, fellow admirers of great literature, let the magic begin. Thank you so much.
I first met Gabriel García Márquez at a dinner at the home of my friends Rose and Bill Styron on Martha's Vineyard about 10 years ago. Since then, it's been a privilege and a pleasure to count this great Latin American writer among my personal friends. I'm delighted to have this opportunity to pay tribute to him and his work. Long before I met him, I had read 100 Years of Solitude, which I still believe is the greatest novel in any language in the last 50 years. It is impossible to calculate the impact of that novel, both in the world's writers and its readers. Our view of Latin America has been immeasurably enriched. In that book and many other wonderful works, Gabriel García Márquez has demonstrated the full extent of the power of literature to pierce to the truth of the spirit and the soul. Another aspect of Gabriel's work which I've learned more about as I've come to know him better is his extraordinary commitment to journalism, exemplified by his lifetime of work as a journalist and with the Foundation for Latin American Journalism, which conducts extensive workshops for young Latin American journalists who are taught by leading journalists from around the world. The foundation also works in a variety of ways to promote innovation and improvement in the Latin American news media. Gabriel's accomplishments as a writer of fiction may be better known to the world, but the foundation holds a special place in his heart and on his schedule, second only to his writing. So I thank you for paying tribute to him tonight. Under the aegis of PEN, an organization of writers founded more than 75 years ago, which has always shared Gabriel García Márquez's commitments to literature, journalism, and freedom of speech. Thank you for honoring my friend and his lifetime of work.
I'm Rose Styron. Can you hear me? I hope. I get to be first among Gabo's friends because President Clinton mentioned that we had all met in Martha's Vineyard, or he had met García Márquez with us in Martha's Vineyard. It was at a dinner party at our house when García Márquez was visiting, and it was in the mid-90s, or later than that, I guess. And that dinner party is etched in my memory for many reasons. The discussions during soup of the American embargo on Cuba, the recital during entrees by Bill Styron, Carlos Fuentes, President Clinton, and Gabriel García Márquez of their favorite books and childhood literary influences. The call from Belfast during dessert urging the president to get involved in the nascent Northern Ireland peace talks. But mostly how aware I became of Gabo again as the supreme intense romantic. I don't mean just his courtliness, his love of and attention to women, though I can't deny the singular appeal of that. When I interviewed him in the late 90s for Voice of America, he said that the only thing he could think of to save the terrible world we were in the 21st century was to turn all power over to women. Yes, right on. He said he thought love was the worst demon, the personal disaster without which he could not live. From his books, you know how remarkably well he observes and appreciates women of every age, the beautiful girls and the young women who grow old and are still adored, as Fermina is in Love in the Time of Cholera. I'll read just a little bit from it. His love awakened in him an overwhelming desire to salvage the sunken treasure from the Spanish galleon that was found so that Fermina Daza could bathe in showers of gold. Years later, when he tried to remember what the maiden idealized by the alchemy of poetry really was like, he could not distinguish her from the heart-rending twilights of those times. Even when he observed her, unseen, during those days of longing, when he waited for a reply to his first letter, he saw her transfigured in the afternoon shimmer of 2 o'clock, in a shower of blossoms from the almond trees, where it was always April, regardless of the season of the year. In this interview I mentioned, he talked gloriously of his grandmother, the constant storyteller who inspired his later fiction. By the way, he said he never distinguished between his journalism and his fiction, except that when he called it journalism, both his feet were on the ground, and in fiction, he allowed himself to fly around the stratosphere. romantic magic realism. I began thinking back over the 30 years since we'd met, and romantic was the word that always surfaced. We met in 1974. Both of us had been in Chile immediately following Pinochet's coup of September 11th, 1973. Gabo as a journalist, I as a scout for Amnesty International, with an extra crazy mission for Penn to bring back Pablo Neruda's latest manuscript, said to be buried by his wife in concrete at a certain corner in Santiago. Mission failed. At that time, Gabo swore publicly that he would not write another word of fiction until Pinochet was routed. Thank God he didn't stick to that. He and I had back-to-back pieces in the magazine Ramparts, which few of you will remember, pieces on torture and death in Santiago. So we were pleased to be introduced by Carlos Fuentes in Mexico City, where survivors of Allende's cabinet and entourage were brought for a Bertrand Russell tribunal. Gabo has as great a capacity for friendship and for fun as he does for serious political commitment. At night, we sat on city steps, singing with Orlando Letelier and Angel Parra the songs they sang for each other during long prison nights in frozen Punta Arenas. They'd just been released. After his principled protest of Pinochet, I remember a decade or so later, his protesting President Reagan's policy in Nicaragua. This assured that at least for the 80s, he'd be denied his dream of obtaining a US visa so he could visit Faulkner's home in Mississippi. Gabriel García Márquez was as much in the Southern literary tradition as Bill Styron. Even in 1990, when the US finally decided he was no longer too dangerous to let in, Gabo was, on the first round, permitted only to visit New York. Mississippi had to wait. I remember him also at the Cannes Film Festival in 1983 when Bill was president of the jury, and we suggested to the unknown and pretty unlikely looking Harvey Weinstein. He was in flowered Bermuda shorts and not much else. That if he wanted to start off the company, he told us he was planning to form the film company, he should take a look at the film Erendera, written by Gabriel García Márquez from one of his own short stories. It was being shown at the Fringe Festival, and we loved it. Gabo was skeptical, but he gave it to Harvey, and behold, Miramax was born. 15 years later, Harvey saw me on the street in Vineyard Haven and said he'd heard that Gabriel García Márquez was coming to the island, and if I'd invite him over to meet his favorite author, he'd sweep floors, pass hors d'oeuvres, anything, so he could ask him for 100 years of solitude to make a film of. Harvey has always had superb taste in books. At that afternoon meeting on our lawn, Gabo told Harvey no, that he didn't want movies made from his novels, but that he was writing short stories and he'd show him one that he thought would be a good film as soon as it was done. Harvey said, please do, I'd like anything. A year later, at 6:45 p.m. in way downtown New York, after our Voice of America interview, Gabo said, let's go see Harvey. He knew, though I didn't, that Miramax was around the corner and felt sure Harvey would still be working. Romantically certain that Harvey would be there to rejoice in the new story Gabo would give him. It didn't turn out exactly that way. The details of that encounter are too long and amusing to relate, but it started with the receptionist saying in Hollywoodese that Mr. Weinstein was taking a meeting, and he certainly could not see a Mr. Garcia Marquez. I urged her to go upstairs and ask him anyway, and she returned huffily saying, "Why didn't you tell me he was Andy Garcia's brother?" So up we went, and there was Andy Garcia taking a meeting with Harvey behind his huge high desk on a platform, and Andy beside him, and Gabo and me on the couch way down here, looking up at the great man. But visiting the great man in Cartagena, the real great man, Gabo, we saw him as the beloved superstar of his native Colombia. As he tour guided us through the ancient city his novels made vivid, he was pursued by groupies of every description, and he always graciously stopped to chat and sign autographs. In 2000, we met Gabo in Havana, a brief but spectacular trip with Arthur Miller and his Inga. At Castro's formal table, I could talk for an hour and so about this, but I promise I won't, Gabo sat next to me doodling his signature flower, whispering in despair to imply we'd be here many more hours, listening to his friend, the dictator, friend whose human rights policies he must despair of. But loyalty goes with friendship, and loyalty to one he knew decades earlier when he was a journalist covering the Warriors' Revolution was foremost in his mind. Suddenly at 1 a.m., Arthur Miller stood up and interrupted our host. "Mr. President," he said, "when we arrived 5 hours ago, you pointed out that I was 12 years and 10 days older than you. Well, now I'm 12 years and 11 days older and I need to go to bed." Castro stood too, apologized profusely, said goodnight, and all the Cuban ministers beamed, and on the way to the car, clapped Arthur on the back, friend Gabo clapping hardest of all. Our most recent visit was to his home in Mexico City, I guess it was March, where in the quiet twilight he showed me around his fantastic library, filled with almost as many books in English as in Spanish. He predicted that great America would surely not be foolish enough to go to war with Iraq. 2 days later, what a romantic.
Well, that's a tough act to follow. John Lee Anderson, good evening. Twenty years ago, when I was just a young reporter living in the Honduran capital of Tegucigalpa, I noticed that an old man, a notable figure, dressed entirely in black in an ancient suit, with a matching black fedora, wandered the narrow streets of the city at the same time every day. He was always alone and he looked immensely sad. I asked about the old man and was told that he was a famous local fixture known as El Cuervo, the Crow, a former executioner of a particularly despicable dictator of the 1930s. Many years earlier, the Crow had come to repent of his bloody past and had donned the black of mourning and dedicated himself of a life of penitence. He'd been wearing his shame in public for as long as anyone could remember. Hearing this story, I thought to myself, this is straight out of Gabriel García Márquez. It was a kind of epiphany for me. I suddenly saw Gabriel García Márquez's fiction on an entirely new level. I saw that history was not a dead thing, that it was kept alive in people's minds, and that it could continue to affect the world we live in mysterious but meaningful ways long after the events. And I realized that the objective truth of the story of the old man was perhaps not as important as what local lore said it was. The old man embodied the country's unreconciled feelings about its past. And this is something that's always stayed with me. What inhabits people's minds is usually more revealing than what one sees on the surface. I don't think I would have come to this understanding if I hadn't already read 100 Years of Solitude. Few authors of modern times have so informed our perceptions, so enhanced our ability to see the multiple realities of the world around us, as has Gabriel García Márquez. And I'm a journalist now, and the fact that Gabo got his start writing as a journalist means a great deal to me. Journalism gave him a steady job while he worked on his fiction. Throughout most of the 1950s and 60s, he supported his family through journalism, and he's never abandoned it entirely. Even though most of the world knows him as the creator of a literary realm that is based on the manipulation of the objective world. Gabo has said that for him, journalism is the most beautiful profession in the world, and that his greatest nostalgia is for the days when he was just a young reporter. I believe that this is not just sweet-sounding rhetoric. Gabo has given generous substance to his words recently by his involvement with the magazine Cambio in Bogota, and by creating the Foundation for New Journalism, based in Cartagena de Indias, the Caribbean city where he first worked as a reporter. He once described his vision for the foundation to me in a tone of fatherly pride, but also with a kind of complicit irreverence, as the nucleus of a genial kind of mafia. The foundation encourages young Latin American journalists, young writers like he once was, by providing a permanent forum for them to learn new techniques, meet and exchange ideas, and form working friendships, which he hopes will be deep and long-lasting. It has been one of my greatest honors over the past few years to have been involved with the foundation, teaching workshops to small groups of fellow reporters from all over the Americas. And based on these experiences, I'd say that Gabo's hopes have been fulfilled. Those who come there are brought there from every corner of Latin America and every social niche. They range from green cub reporters to seasoned veterans well into their careers. There are those who are self-taught and poor from obscure provincial newspapers, and others who are urban sophisticates who've had the advantages of top-notch educations, world travel, and good incomes. Some are already media stars and household names in their own countries, but in Cartagena they are equals, and they sit shoulder to shoulder as students. What brings them there is their desire to learn, to improve their skills at communicating their diverse realities, and no doubt the common hope that some of Gabo's magic might rub off on them. To my great delight, and I'm sure Gabo shares this pleasure, I've seen how many of these students stay in contact with one another after their Cartagena sojourns, and how, in many different ways, they've begun to form precisely the kind of genial mafia Gabo had in mind, encouraging one another, trading ideas, access and contacts, and even embarking on joint projects together. They're united by the reality of Gabo's example, and the lesson that you start thinking about things by looking closely at what is in front of you. That's the way Gabo started, although he ended up interpreting historical reality through his own special genius. But he never lost his respect nor his sense of camaraderie for those of us who toil solely on the literal level. And his inspiration, material support, and moral example have been a priceless gift. Thank you.
Good evening, I'm Paul Auster. It was the spring of 1970. I was 23 years old, writing and translating poems, writing essays and reviews, but also dreaming of one day being able to write novels. I had read nearly everything by then, all the masters of the 20th century, Joyce and Proust, Kafka and Beckett, Faulkner and Nabokov, Fitzgerald and Celine, Borges and Gombrowicz, and quite frankly, was feeling a little crushed. How on earth can I ever get out from under those giants? One day, I read a highly enthusiastic review of a novel by a South American writer whose name was unknown to me. At the time, 33 years ago, buying hardcover books was an extravagance I could scarcely afford, but my curiosity had been aroused to such a degree that I went out and sprang for the book anyway. I started reading 100 Years of Solitude in the early afternoon, and I didn't put it down until I had finished reading it late that night. Here was something new and fresh and altogether mesmerizing. An imagination, a voice, a sensibility that resembled nothing I had encountered before. And yet, Gabriel García Márquez's novel, in the masterful translation by Gregory Rabassa, contained many old-fashioned virtues as well, most of which can be summed up in a single phrase, a love of storytelling. This love is what creates pleasure in the reader, the sense of amazement and happiness that wash over us whenever we stumble upon one of those rare books that changes the way we look at the world, that exposes us to the infinite possibilities of what a book can be. Every passionate reader has had that experience, and each time it happens to us, we understand that books are a world unto themselves, and that that world is better and richer than anyone we have traveled in before. That is why we become readers in the first place. That is why we turn away from the vanities of the material world and begin to love books above all other things. Thank you, Gabriel García Márquez, for giving me that experience. And thank you for taking me by the hand and leading me into the future. Now I'd like to read excerpts from a story by García Márquez. Sleeping Beauty and the Airplane, translated by Edith Grossman. She was beautiful and lithe, with soft skin the color of bread and eyes like green almonds. And she had straight black hair that reached to her shoulders and an aura of antiquity that could just as well have been Indonesian as Andean. She was dressed with subtle taste, a lynx jacket, a raw silk blouse with very delicate flowers, natural linen trousers, and shoes with a narrow stripe the color of bougainvillea. This is the most beautiful woman I've ever seen, I thought when I saw her pass by with the stealthy stride of a lioness while I waited in the check-in line at Charles de Gaulle Airport in Paris for the plane to New York. She was a supernatural apparition who existed only for a moment and disappeared into the crowd in the terminal. The flight to New York, scheduled for 11 in the morning, left at 8 that night. By the time I managed to board, the other first-class passengers were already in their seats, and a flight attendant led me to mine. My heart stopped. In the seat next to mine, beside the window, Beauty was taking possession of her space with the mastery of an expert traveler. If I ever wrote this, nobody would believe me, I thought. And I just managed to stammer an indecisive greeting that she did not hear. She settled in as if she were going to live there for many years, putting each thing in its proper place and order, until her seat was arranged like the ideal house, where everything was within reach. In the meantime, a steward brought us our welcoming champagne. I took a glass to offer to her, but thought better of it just in time, for she wanted only a glass of water, and she asked the steward, first in incomprehensible French, and then in an English only somewhat more fluent, not to wake her for any reason during the flight. Her warm, serious voice was tinged with oriental sadness. When he brought the water, she placed the cosmetics case with copper corners, like a grandmother's trunk, on her lap, and took two golden pills from a box that contained others of various colors. She did everything in a methodical, solemn way, as if nothing unforeseen had happened to her since birth. At last, she pulled down the shade on the window, lowered the back of her seat as far as it would go, covered herself to the waist with a blanket without taking off her shoes, put on a sleeping mask, turned her back to me, and then slept without a single pause, without a sigh, without the slightest change in position, for the 8 eternal hours and 12 extra minutes of the flight to New York. It was an ardent journey. I have always believed that there is nothing more beautiful in nature than a beautiful woman, and it was impossible for me to escape, even for a moment, from the spell of that storybook creature who slept at my side. The steward disappeared as soon as we took off and was replaced by a Cartesian attendant who tried to awaken Beauty to hand her a toiletry case and a set of earphones for listening to music. I repeated the instructions she had given the steward, but the attendant insisted on hearing from Beauty's own lips that she did not want supper either. The steward had to confirm her instructions, and even so, he approached me because Beauty had not hung the little cardboard "Do Not Disturb" sign around her neck. I ate a solitary supper, telling myself in silence everything I would have told her if she had been awake. Her sleep was so steady that at one point I had the distressing thought that the pills she had taken were not for sleeping, but for dying. With each drink, I raised my glass and toasted her. To your health, Beauty. When supper was over, the lights were dimmed and a movie was shown to no one, and the two of us were alone in the darkness of the world. The biggest storm of the century had ended, and the Atlantic night was immense and limpid, and the plain seemed motionless among the stars. Then I contemplated her inch by inch for several hours, and the only sign of life I could detect were the shadows of the dreams that passed along her forehead like clouds over water. Around her neck, she wore a chain so fine, it was almost invisible against her golden skin. Her perfect ears were unpierced, her nails were rosy with good health, and on her left hand was a plain band. Since she looked no older than 20, I consoled myself with the idea that it was not a wedding ring, but the sign of an ephemeral engagement. To know you are sleeping, certain, secure, faithful channel of renunciation, pure line, so close to my manacled arms, I thought on the foaming crest of champagne, repeating the masterful sonnet by Gerardo Diego. Then I lowered the back of my seat to the level of hers, and we lay together. Closer than if we had been in a marriage bed. The climate of her breathing was the same as that of her voice, and her skin exhaled a delicate breath that could only be the scent of her beauty. I think I slept several hours, conquered by champagne and the mute explosions of the movie, and when I awoke, my head was splitting. I went to the bathroom. After I got rid of the excesses of champagne, I caught sight of myself, contemptible and ugly, in the mirror, and was amazed that the devastation of love could be so terrible. The plane lost altitude without warning, then managed to straighten out and continue full speed ahead. The return to your seat sign went on. I hurried out with the hope that God's turbulence might awaken Beauty, and she would have to take refuge in my arms to escape her terror. Beauty's sleep was invincible. When the plane stabilized, I had to resist the temptation to shake her on some pretext, because all I wanted in the last hour of the flight was to see her awake, even if she were furious, so that I could recover my freedom and perhaps my youth. But I couldn't do it. Damn it, I said to myself with a great scorn, why wasn't I born a Taurus? She awoke by herself at the moment the landing lights went on, and she was as beautiful and refreshed as if she had slept in a rose garden. That was when I realized that, like old married couples, people who sit next to each other on airplanes do not say good morning to each other when they wake up. nor did she. She took off her mask, opened her radiant eyes, straightened the back of the seat, moved the blanket aside, shook her hair that fell into place of its own weight, put the cosmetics case back on her knees, and applied rapid, unnecessary makeup, which took just enough time so that she did not look at me until the plane door opened. Then she put on a lynx jacket, almost stepped over me with a conventional excuse in pure Latin American Spanish, left without even saying goodbye, or at least thanking me for all I had done to make our night together a happy one, and disappeared into the sun of today in the Amazon jungle of New York. Thank you.
Buenas noches. José Manuel Prieto, mi nombre. En 1981, cuando viajé a Siberia a conocer el hielo, tenía 19 años y debía hacer un viaje de 27 días por barco y por tren desde La Habana hasta la ciudad de Novosibirsk a 12 husos horarios de mi casa. Muchos meses después, abrumado ya por un previsible futuro de ingeniero que no quería para mí, salí una noche de invierno a caminar bajo la nieve. Mi paseo me llevó a una plaza en el centro de la ciudad, en la que fui asaltado por una visión que me dejó clavado en el lugar sin atreverme a dar un paso. Un enorme Kremlin o citadela amurallada hecha de grande hielo. Sus altos muros de hielo, sus torres de hielo, y sus almenas de hielo. Sin salir de mi asombro, lo recuerdo perfectamente, sin dejar de mirar extasiado aquel portento, me acerqué al rutilante castillo y posé la mano en sus blancos sillares al tiempo que exclamaba en voz muy baja, es el diamante más grande del mundo. Porque en aquella época yo tenía más García Márquez en el torrente sanguíneo que otra cosa, y esa frase de la célebre escena del descubrimiento del hielo bajo la carpa de un circo en Macondo, afloró sin esfuerzo mis labios a la vista de aquel edificio imposible, de una fortaleza erigida siguiendo al pie de la letra el principio constructor esbozado en 100 años de soledad. Lo que comprendí entonces, paseando por dentro del Kremlin de hielo, atisbando el interior nuboso de los témpanos aserrados en las aguas congeladas de los ríos siberianos, fue que las maravillas de aquel libro debían ser entendidas tal cual, que era, paradójicamente, el mejor libro de viajes concebible, la mejor descripción de Siberia que uno pudiera imaginar, un libro indispensable para entender sus paisajes nevados, la mágica realidad de sus largas noches, la pasmosa presencia de ciudades de hielo como la que había imaginado mi tocayo José Arcadio. Solo que yo, intencionalmente, lo había dejado en La Habana porque de haberlo leído tantas veces, el libro había llevado a tener un influjo hipnótico en mí. Un libro, una lengua única, el español de Márquez, del que debía desprenderme. Pero la visión que tuve esa noche me hizo regresar a él y leerlo en la única versión que, como es lógico, pude comprar en Siberia, en ruso. Pasé meses leyéndolo en aquella lengua con la misma tosudez que el último los buen días dedica a desentrañar la escritura cifrada de Melquiades, viendo caer la nieve por la ventana, maravillado por la exacta descripción de la vida afuera. Ya lo he dicho, la ciudad de hielo, pero también, y una vez más, por la perturbadora presencia del amor adolescente, por la desmesura parrandera de Aureliano II, tan exactamente repetida en las borracheras de mis amigos rusos. La nostalgia de los inventores, la hazaña con que los hombres se entregan a su mutuo exterminio. Solo así, reentrando desde tan lejos, disminuida en la traducción la presencia fulgurante e hipnótica de su inconfundible prosa, sus relucientes paredes de espejo, logré romper el encantamiento en que su lectura me había sumido. Dejé de atribuir el libro, su aparición, a un milagro inexplicable y comencé poco a poco una tarea que aún no termina, a elaborar una explicación personal para el principio de funcionamiento de uno de mis libros más queridos y, sin lugar a duda, uno de los más importantes y entrañables, no solo para sus millones de lectores, sino para un escritor en español o en cualquier otra lengua. Creí haber descubierto su estructura de friso griego, el presente eterno de la estela, que le permite al autor desplazarse por todo el frente de la obra y escoger el rasgo, el detalle que desde el pasado o el presente, en realidad porciones siempre existentes en el friso, le sirve para hablar mejor de un personaje, explicar sus móviles hoy, ya presentes en lo que hará mañana o hizo muchos años antes. No he dejado todos estos años de volver a él, a toda la obra de Márquez, movido por un profundo agradecimiento al mago, al hipnotizador, a la fuerza única de su español, al hacedor de libros tan maravillosos que llegaron a inocularme la ambición desmedida de imitarlo, de crear mis propios artilugios hipnóticos. Una vida de lectura y de lucha brazo partido con la escritura, un friso menor que ahora tengo ante mis ojos con la misma claridad del narrador de 100 años, en el que no ha dejado de estar nunca Gabriel García Márquez como un gran rapsodo antiguo. A esas zonas de emoción, a esas regiones de asombro infinito, a esos vastos parajes de admiración sin medida, he ido a buscar mis palabras de hoy. Muchas gracias.
Hi, I'm Patricia Cepeda, and I will give you José Manuel's words in an English version. In 1981, when I went to Siberia to become acquainted with ice, I was 19 years old. I traveled for 27 days by boat and train from Havana to the city of Novosibirsk in a time zone 12 hours difference from my home in Havana. Many months later, besieged by thoughts of an all too foreseeable future as an engineer, which I did not want, I went out one winter for a walk in the snow. My stroll took me to the square at the center of the city, where I suddenly came upon a vision that assaulted me and left me riveted. It was a vast Kremlin or walled citadel built from great blocks of ice, high walls of ice, battlements of ice, towers of ice. Still deep in my astonishment, and without taking my eyes from this wonder, I walked towards the dazzling castle and put my hands on its white masonry, exclaiming under my breath, "It's the largest diamond in the world." At that time in my life, I had more García Márquez in my bloodstream than anything else. And the phrase from the famous moment of discovery of ice in a circus tent in Macondo came to me immediately at the sight of that impossible edifice. That fortress built in precise accordance with the principles of construction outlined in 100 Years of Solitude. What I understood then, as I wandered to that Kremlin of ice, looking into the cloudy interior of the flows sawed off from the frozen waters of Siberian rivers, was that the wonders of that book are to be taken literally. That is, paradoxically, the greatest travel book imaginable. The best description of Siberia that can be conceived, and indispensable for understanding the snowy landscape, the magical unreality of the long nights, the amazing existence of cities built of ice, like the one imagined by José Arcadio Buendía, my namesake. Except that I had left the book back in Havana on purpose, because I had read it so many times, it had begun to exert a hypnotic influence on me. It was both a book and a unique language, García Márquez in Spanish, from which I had to detach myself. But the vision of that evening made me go back to it and read it again in the only version available to me at the time, in Russian. I spent months reading it in that language with the same obstinacy that the last of the Buendías dedicates to the unraveling the writings of Melquiades, watching the snow fall through the window, amazed by the exact description of life outside the city of ice. But again, by the disturbing presence of adolescent love, the epic binges of Aureliano II, so precisely repeated in the drunken sprees of my Russian friends, the inventor's nostalgia, the brutality with which men dedicate themselves to their mutual extermination. And only by going back to it from so far away and with the blazing hypnotic presence of its unmistakable style, those glittering walls of mirrors diminished by translation, did I manage to break the enchantment that the book had cast over me. I stopped attributing the book, the existence of the book, to an inexplicable miracle and embarked little by little on a task I still have not completed, coming up with a personal explanation for the operating principle of one of the books I loved most, which is also undoubtedly one of the most important and intimate books, not only for its millions of readers, but also for any writer in Spanish or in any other language. I believe that I discovered its structure was like a Greek frieze, the eternal present of the stela, which allows the author to move easily across the surface of the work and find the feature, the detail, either past or present, since all the parts of the frieze are always there, that best allows him to speak of a character and explain his current motives, which already exist in what he will do tomorrow or in what he did many years earlier. In the years since then, I've never stopped going back to him, to all his work, moved by a deep gratitude for the unique force of his Spanish, for the magician, the hypnotist, the maker of books so marvelous they managed to inoculate me against the inordinate ambition of imitating him and creating hypnotic devices of my own. A life of reading and hand-to-hand combat with writing, a lesser frieze that I now have before my eyes with the same clarity as the narrator of 100 Years of Solitude, and in which Gabriel García Márquez has never ceased to be a present, the great rhapsodist of antiquity. It is to those realms of feeling, those regions of infinite astonishment, those great landscapes of admiration without measure that I've gone to seek these words this evening. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Edith Grossman. Ralph Manheim, the great translator from the German, compared the translator to an actor who speaks as the author would if the author spoke English. A sophisticated and provocative analogy, for it takes into account something that is not always as clear as it should be, at least to many reviewers, whose highest endorsement for a translation tends to be that it is seamless. If I may attempt to translate the damnation barely concealed in their faint praise, I think they really mean that the translator has, with proper humility, made herself or himself invisible, a punishing goal that is desirable only if we are held personally responsible for the Tower of Babel and all its dire consequences for our species. Fidelity is surely our highest aim, but a translation is not made with tracing paper. It is an act of critical interpretation. Let me insist on the obvious. Languages trail immense individual histories behind them, and no two languages, with all their accretions of tradition and culture, ever dovetail perfectly. They can be linked by translation, as a photograph can link movement and stasis, but it is disingenuous to assume that either translation or photography, or acting for that matter, are representational in any narrow sense of the term. Fidelity is our noble purpose, but it does not have much, if anything, to do with what is called literal meaning. A translation can be faithful to tone and intention, to meaning. It can rarely be faithful to words or syntax, for these are peculiar to specific languages and are not transferable. To create significance for a new set of readers, translators must make the effort to enter the mind of the first author through the gateway of the text, to see the world through another person's eyes and translate the linguistic perception of that world into another language. The better the original writing, the more exciting and challenging the process is. You can be sure that the attempt to enter the mind of García Márquez is as exciting and challenging as the work of a translator gets. His most recent book, Living to Tell the Tale, is the first volume of a projected three-volume memoir, though I am sure there will be those who insist that it is fiction, as some did, especially in the UK, when news of a kidnapping was first published, and people who should have known better refused to believe that the book was a piece of investigative reporting. The possible reason for their misapprehension is made explicit in Living to Tell the Tale. In a series of fascinating comments, García Márquez makes it clear that he sees little distinction between the practice of journalism and the writing of fiction. This is certainly not a question of his confusing truth and imagination or reality and fantasy, and it is much more than a clever turn of phrase or thought. Over and over again in the memoir, he refers to incidents and situations that are familiar to the reader because they have appeared, transmuted, and transposed in the works of fiction. Even more important than events mined from the motherlode of his experience, however, is the repertorial narrative technique common to both genres in García Márquez's writing. He is a master of physical observation, surfaces, appearances, external realities, spoken words, everything that a truly observant observer can observe. He makes almost no allusion to states of mind, motivations, emotions, internal responses. Those are left to the inferential skills and deductive interests of the reader. In other words, García Márquez has turned the fly on the wall point of view into a crucial aspect of his narrative style in both fiction and nonfiction, and it is a strategy that he uses to stunning effect. It not only obliges readers to participate in the narration by placing them up on the wall right next to the fly, but I believe it is also one of the techniques he employs to abrogate sentimentality, leaving only actions driven by emotions and sometimes passions. It is a joy and a privilege beyond the telling of it to translate the profoundly expressive and artful writing of the maestro. Thank you, Gabo, for your books. Thank you. I would like to take a moment to recognize the presence here tonight of a man whom I admire greatly, the man responsible for the introduction of García Márquez and an entire generation of Latin American novelists to the English-speaking world, the man who translated such masterpieces as 100 Years of Solitude and The Autumn of the Patriarch, and the man who has been, over the years, an inspiration to all of us who translate. It is an honor for me to welcome Gregory Rabassa.
Before I start on García Márquez, I would like to add my greetings and great good wishes to Gregory Rabassa, about whom I've written a lot, a terrific fiction writer who disguises it as translation. And I remember that Gabo said that he doesn't translate phrase by phrase. He reads the book and then he writes it. Hello, Gregory, where are you? I want to begin by quoting the first paragraph of my review of 100 Years of Solitude when the book was first published in this country 32 years ago. This novel I wrote, quote, is the first piece of literature since the book of Genesis that should be required reading for the entire human race. takes up not long after Genesis left off and carries through to the Air Age, reporting on everything that happened in between with more lucidity, wit, wisdom, and poetry than is expected from 100 years of novelists, let alone one man. Well, that was a fairly prophetic paragraph in that the book seems to have become second only to the Bible as a universal text, and I think the Bible is losing ground. However, I also must quote my next sentence in the review, which was about the man who wrote this wonderful book. That man, I said, is Gabriel García Márquez, an Argentine of incredibly magical imagination. This appeared in 1970 in the National Observer, the Dow Jones Sunday newspaper, under the headline, "All of Life, Sense, and Nonsense Fills an Argentine's Daring Fable." Well, the book jacket and the publicity release had carried no biographical information, only a line that it had been written in Latin America. I think the publishers were trying to pass Gabo off as an American. The book's copyright page, however, noted its first Spanish language publication was Buenos Aires, 1967, hence the author, to me and my editor, was an Argentine. 2 years later, the spring of 1972, I went to Spain to discover the author for America, for despite the ascending reverence for his book, García Márquez, the man, was still a well-kept secret. When we talked in Barcelona, I admitted my Argentine goof, and he said, "Ah, so you're the one." My wife and I had been invited to Paris, and after that I decided we'd take the overnight train to Spain for the interview. I was living in genteel poverty in those days, so I thought I'd enhance our travel bankroll with a magazine advance for a piece on the man I thought I was about to bring out of illustrious anonymity. So I called three major magazines. One wasn't interested. The second said the author should go out and get himself famous and then they'd do a piece. The third said they'd look at my story, but no advance. I said, to hell with you all, and I decided I'd work on spec, which is the journalistic term for zilch. In Barcelona, I phoned Gabo and I asked, "Do you speak English?" "Nada," he said. Which wasn't true, but that was his pose. I spoke my rusty Spanish and he said we'd meet at 5 on La Rambla, old Barcelona's great thoroughfare. 10 minutes later he called back, my Spanish better than I thought, and he said we'd meet at noon instead of 5. And here he came down La Rambla in navy blue sports jacket, gray slacks, open collar blue shirt, full head of curly black hair, and a lush goatee. His method, he later explained, was to meet interviewers in public, stay long enough to be civil, then leave. If the interview went well, he'd extend it. We were talking over street noise, and I suggested someplace quiet. "It's hard to find that in Spain," he said. He pointed to a bar and he said, "It's American, nobody goes there." So we went and we talked quietly for 2 hours. I'll only quote one question he asked from the blue. "What do you think of Graham Greene?" I said I had a high opinion of Greene, and I think that clinched the interview for me. "He teaches you how to write," Gabo said. "His technique of narration is so good. Intellectuals would like Greene, but they don't think they should. The intellectual is the worst thing there is. He invents things and then he believes them. He decides the novel is dead, but then he finds the novel and he says he discovered it. If you say the novel is dead, it is not the novel. It is you who are dead." Well, we talked for 2 hours and Gabo didn't flee. He invited us to his home at 5 o'clock for more talk and late dinner. We met his wife and Mercedes, their sons Gonzalo and Rodrigo, who were then 10 and 12. My wife, Dana, who is Puerto Rican and fluent in Spanish, translated for us. After a few scotches, Gabo was speaking English to me, and Dana was translating my Spanish to him in English. There was no time to record our conversation, which carried on for 9 hours until 2 a.m. at Barcelona's best secret restaurant. I offer only one story, which gave title to the piece I wrote, The Yellow Trolley Car in Barcelona. It appeared in The Atlantic and also in The Observer's Sunday magazine in England in 1972, the first biographical articles on Gabo in either country. My publisher likes me to say it also appears in my collection, Riding the Yellow Trolley Car, Penguin 1295, and in Canada 1699. When our Paris train crossed into Spain at Port Bou, we picked up a brochure detailing the trolley lines in Barcelona. I rode trolleys in adolescence and have been a trolley car freak ever since. I didn't know until someone pointed it out that trolleys appear in all my novels except Legs, and that one has a train, which is something like a trolley. So Dana and I looked for a trolley at Columbus Plaza, and a coconut vendor said Barcelona hadn't had any trolleys in 15 years. So why was Spain touting them in the tourist brochures? The coconut man wasn't sure. We took a bus instead and stood in the back looking out the large rear window at the receding canyon of splendid buildings, which reminded me of photographs I remembered from New York's Fifth Avenue in the 19th century. And suddenly I said to Dana, there's a trolley. She missed it. Its movement was perpendicular to ours, and it was visible only a few seconds, no more, and about three blocks back, and then it disappeared behind the canyon wall. At his house, I eventually asked Gabo, what trolleys still run in Barcelona? He and Mercedes said there were no trolleys, only a funicular. I said, I saw a trolley, and it was yellow and old-fashioned in design. Mercedes said the funicular was blue. Gabo phoned his agent, Carmen Balcells. Is there a yellow trolley car in Barcelona, he asked her. I'm here having an interview with Kennedy, and he saw a yellow trolley car. Carmen said all trolleys were yellow in the old days. She called back a little later to report that 2 years ago at a public ceremony, the last trolley in Barcelona had been formally buried. What had I seen? I have no idea, except that it was a trolley car. To me, this is completely natural, Gabo said, and he told a story. My wife and I were asleep and the doorbell rings, he said. I opened the door and a man says to me, I came to fix the ironing cord. My wife from the bed says, we don't have anything wrong with the iron here. The man says, is this apartment too? No, I say, upstairs. Later, my wife went to the iron and plugged it in and it burned up. This was a reversal. The man came before we knew it had to be fixed. This type of thing happens all the time. My wife has already forgotten it. A world in which ironing cords incinerate prematurely is the world we associate with García Márquez. Not only in 100 years of solitude, but in the autumn of the patriarch, innocent or under, and much more. In Love and the Time of the Cholera, he moved to more realistic storytelling. But the embrace by writers of what has come to be called his magical realism, and I'm sure he loathes that phrase, has become as universal a tool for storytelling as Joyce's interior monologue, and it no longer belongs only to Gabo. Of course, it never did. Such writing is as old as Homer and as modern as Kafka. Even so, Gabo is stuck with it. And as such, his work was recently decreed passé by a new school of young Latin American realists who have replaced, for their own satisfaction, Gabo's mythic town of Macondo with their own mock town of Micondo, as in McDonald's or McNuggets. Latin America, they say, is no longer cute. No more levitating priests or storms of butterflies. They want to write and read dirty realism about contemporary life, raw sex and violence in the apolitical lower depths. To some of us, that sounds like the place from which an earlier generation departed. But of course, every world is valuable when the writer is navigating through the unknown. Here's Gabo's take on all this. People believe I'm a writer of fantastic fiction, when actually I'm a very realistic person and write what I believe is the true socialist realism, unquote. I agree totally with that. And now that I think about it, I realize that that was a socialist yellow trolley car I saw in Barcelona. It's the only possible explanation. Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Edwidge Danticat. Many of us who come from the Caribbean are astounded when people speak of the implausibility of magical realism. For in our worldview, as in Gabriel García Márquez, a lot of what is considered magically realistic seems more realistic than magical. Of course a woman can live inside her cat. We have an aunt that's done that. And remember our neighbor who died but kept growing in his coffin? Our parents swear that that's true. What seems much more unusual are those moments when the world is calm, almost normal, when there are no wars, no dictators, when a writer survives a life of strife to live 75 glorious and prodigious years, and when a character, an ordinary dentist, takes revenge on a murderer, as in this excerpt from a 1962 short story by Gabriel García Márquez. One of these days. Monday dawn warm and rainless, Aurelio Escobar, a dentist without a degree, opened his office at 6. He took some false teeth, still mounted in this plaster mold, out of the glass case and put on the table a fistful of instrument, which he arranged in size order. The shrill voice of his 11-year-old son interrupted his concentration. Papa, what? The mayor wants to know if you'll pull his tooth. Tell him I'm not here. His son shouted again from the little waiting room. He says you are too because he can hear you. The dentist kept examining a tooth. Papa, what? He says if you don't take out his tooth, he'll shoot you. Without hurrying, he pulled the lower drawer of the table all the way out. There was a revolver. Okay, he said, tell him to come and shoot me. The mayor appeared at the door. He had shaven the side of his face, but the other side, swollen and in pain, had a five-day-old beard. The dentist saw many nights of desperation in his dull eyes. He closed the drawer with his fingertips and said softly, sit down. Good morning, said the mayor. Morning, said the dentist. When he felt the dentist approach, the mayor braced his heels and opened his mouth. Aurelio Escobar turned his head towards the light. After inspecting the tooth, he closed the mayor's jaw with the cautious pressure of his fingers. It has to be without anesthesia, he said. Why? Because you have an abscess. The mayor looked him in the eye. All right, he said, and tried to smile. The dentist did not return the smile. He brought the basin of sterilized instruments to the work table and took them out with a pair of cold tweezers. Then he pushed a spittoon with the tip of his shoe and went to wash his hand in the wash basin. It was a lower wisdom tooth. The dentist spread his feet and grasped the tooth with the forceps. The mayor seized the arms of the chair, braced his feet with all his strength, and felt an icy void in his kidneys, but didn't make a sound. The dentist moved only his wrist. Without rancor, rather with a bitter tenderness, he said, now you will pay for our 20 dead men. The mayor felt the crunch of bones in his jaw and his eyes filled with tears, but he didn't breathe until he felt the tooth come out. Then he saw it through his tears. It seemed so foreign to his pain that he failed to understand his torture of the five previous nights. Bent over the spittoon, sweating, panting, he unbuttoned his tunic and reached for the handkerchief in his pants pocket. The dentist gave him a clean cloth. Dry your tears, he said. The mayor was trembling. The dentist returned, drying his hands. Go to bed, he said, and gargle with salt water. The mayor stood up, said goodbye with a casual military salute, and walk to his door, stretching his legs without buttoning up his tunic. "Send the bill," the mayor said. "To you or to the town?" asked the dentist. The mayor didn't look at him. He closed the door and said through the screen, "It's the same damn thing. Thank you."
Hi, I'm Francisco Goldman. It is often remarked that Gabriel García Márquez's writings are read by people of all classes in Latin America, that his stories and characters have become a part of Latin American everyday mythology in a way comparable to the influence in their own cultures of the creations of such writers as Dickens, Balzac, Twain, and Tolstoy. I've seen that verified countless times, including here in New York, in a remote corner of the Red Hook seaport 20 years ago, when I went to meet the Central American sailors who'd been living like urban Robinson Crusoes for months on an abandoned cargo freighter without anyone knowing they were there, and the 73-year-old Nicaraguan, the phantom ship's mess waiter, told me, "We're like the colonel nobody writes to." So few were surprised when the feminist anthropologist Pilar Segura published in 1997 in the journal Métodos y Heteroglossia her study establishing, via the most rigorous methodology, that the book, apart from the Bible, most often found in the personal possession of sex workers throughout Latin America, was Gabriel García Márquez's Love in the Time of Cholera. In a San Pedro Sula, Honduras brothel, one of the study's subjects, when asked by Pilar Segura what it was she most liked about the novel, replied, "The sentiments of his characters, the way he writes not just about emotional things, but about life itself." And she told the anthropologist that she had a notebook which she'd filled with her favorite phrases and passages from the book. "If I go on reading this chavo," she told Dr. Segura, "he's going to become my amor platónico." How I would like to have known what passages that anonymous young woman had chosen for her notebook. Rereading Pilar Segura's essay last night, I was especially struck by her declarations about what she most liked in García Márquez's writing. I agreed with her. Even his most suffocated characters have an inner radiance, like electrically loaded rain at night. A comparison can be made with Kafka. Instead of dwelling solipsistically on the neurotic anxieties and fixations of Gregory Samsa, he transformed him into a cockroach, and readers all over the world saw themselves in that bug. García Márquez also takes private obsessions, enigmatic emotions, the most neurotic, twisted, and self-defeating behavior, and transforms it, distills it into pure action, image, story. Amaranta burning up with love and spurning love over and over. Her long life like the funeral shroud she finally weaves for herself, alternating threads of meanness and tenderness. Amaranta's lifelong rancor, which is finally only her invincible and heartbreaking terror of love. In a 650-page study of Gabriel García Márquez, Historia de un Diecillo, published in 1971, the Peruvian novelist Mario Vargas Llosa reminds us that García Márquez began his writing career in a time of, quote, guerrilla warfare in the countryside, urban terrorism, campaigns of repression, widespread torture and political crimes, unquote. That Colombia in which 300,000 citizens were killed in less than a decade. So much of García Márquez's fiction was not only written against the backdrop of political violence, but is also an answer to that violence, a lesson in how the novelist uses reality to supplant reality, and perhaps helps the reader reimagine that reality in some personally saving or even liberating way of his own. I remember a night in Guatemala City in the 1980s, a time of violence as horrific as the one that had ravaged Colombia more than three decades before. I lived in my late grandmother's house and was trying and failing to begin a novel. Moral indignation, political hatred strangled my every word. Other journalists sometimes lived in that house, including my friend Jean-Marie Simon, the great photojournalist and human rights activist. One night the doorbell rang. I answered the door and found a young woman who said she had an appointment with Jean-Marie. She wore a woolen cap and a florid scarf wrapped loosely around her neck and lifted over her nose, as if against the blown-up grit and billowing black exhaust from the junk-canned buses roaring by. Jean Ray was out, I told her, but I invited her up to wait. She said her name was Flora. I made her a cup of tea and sat down to make small talk. The people who came to see Jean Marie often had the most urgent manners to discuss, and I knew not to pry. A copy of 100 Years of Solitude, which I was rereading, lay on the table. Flora remarked that she was reading The Autumn of the Patriarch. Imagine, she said, reading a book about a dictator and feeling sorry for him. Guatemala's then dictator, General Mejia Victoriz, had just presided over the Holy Week massacre of leaders of Guatemala's first families of the disappeared group, including a paternal baker and a young mother, along with her teenage brother and her infant daughter. In Flora's face, in her soft black eyes, I saw something which reminded me of a description I'd read by García Márquez that same day, the painful look of plowed ground. Ah, ese hombre, she said, shaking her head, picking up my copy of 100 Years of Solitude. He's like an angel of compassion. A compassion that explains everything about us. Look at this, and she read out loud from the book. In the haze of convalescence, surrounded by Remedios' dusty dolls, Colonel Aureliano Buendia brought back the decisive periods of his existence by reading the poetry he had written at that time. What does he mean? After so many years of warfare and death, why do a few months of marriage to a child bride count as the decisive moments of a great rebel leader's life? Flipping back through the book, she said, she marries him, and she takes care of his senile father when no one else wants to, even washes him and picks lice from her father-in-law's hair. And when her husband fathers a child with a town whore, she uncomplainingly welcomes the baby into the family. And she fills the house with laughter and song and so on, the perfect little wife, the only happy Buendia marriage in the whole book, and it's to a happily self-abnegating 11-year-old child bride. And what does that good fortune do for Colonel Aureliano Buendia? And Flora read, it did not increase his weight or alter the parsimony of his character, but on the contrary, it hardened on his lips the straight line of solitary meditation and implacable decision. Ay, vos, you see, it's all in here, sighed Flora. No wonder our countries get so fucked up. I'd guess that Flora must be some kind of human rights person. But later, I found out from Jean Marie that Flora was really the ORPA guerrilla leader, Subcomandante Ethelvina. That was her nom de guerre. Years later, scrutinizing a smudgy author's photo in the journal Métodos y Heteroglossia, I realized that she'd survived the war and gone on to become Dr. Pilar Segura. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Salman Rushdie. I remember when I published my first very unsuccessful novel, a science fiction novel, which I keep to the despair of my publishers telling people not to read. A friend of mine who read it said that it reminded him of García Márquez, who at that point I had not read. And he said you should, in that case, immediately go and read 100 Years of Solitude. To which my response was, really? 100 years of solitude? yes, said my friend. And of course, when I did read it, I had the experience that many people have described tonight of being forever lost in that great novel. Unforgettable. I think all of us who have read tonight can actually remember the day we first read García Márquez. It's that colossal an event. And one of the things that it struck me, which also struck me when I first went to Latin America, was the incredible similarity between the world he was describing and the world that I knew from South Asia, from India and Pakistan. Also a world in which religion and superstition dominated people's lives, also a world in which there was a powerful and complicated history of colonialism, also a world in which there were colossal differences between the very poor and the very rich and not that much in between, also a world which was bedeviled by dictators and corruption. And so to me, also reading these books, what was called fantastic seemed completely naturalistic. And I think it's the great achievement of García Márquez to recognize something which literature perhaps needs to rediscover all the time, which is that reality is not realistic. This is something I think we're beginning all to recognize. Have you noticed how weird things are lately? We look out at what is supposed to be the humdrum surface of what we are led to believe is the real, and out of it there burst these curious growths. What could one call them? Bushes. And now we have to deal with that. I mean, compared to that, the world of these books is ridiculous understatement. I remember reading an account in India of the project of an almost certainly insane academic to enumerate the total number of gods in India. You know, not just the famous above the title deities, you know, but also all the little gods of place and grove and stream and so on. And after what must have been a lifetime of labor, he came up with the spectacular figure of 300 million. You know, 300 million gods. This is the population of India is about 1 billion. Human beings, and so that provides one god for every 3.3 human beings. It's a very personal service godhead. And it's kind of like going to private school, you know, very small classes. I remember that when I was young, the figure given for the population of India used to be half that. It used to be about 500 million because the population of India has more or less doubled since the 1950s. The divine population has presumably been reasonably stable. Gods having better contraceptive devices, no doubt. So if you project the population curve backwards, you realize there must have been a time in the late 30s or the early 40s when for the first time the human population of India overtook the divine population. That is realism. You know? And that is what García Márquez reintroduced us all to and taught us to see. It's always there to see, but García Márquez taught us to see it. And I think one of the great achievements, the great machines of 100 Years of Solitude, which is the book to which I keep coming back in spite of the greatness of all the other books, is the inversion of reality that takes place between the village and the city. And what García Márquez does in this book is always to privilege the worldview of the village over the worldview of the city. So that when Remedios the Beauty, a girl far too good for this world, rises into heaven, surrounded by sheets, by bed sheets, which also float up. Everybody immediately accepts this as being perfectly understandable, you know. The only thing they hope is that they will get the sheets back. However, one of the strangest, the most fantastic, fabulous, magic realist moments in 100 Years of Solitude are reserved for the arrivals in Macondo of technology. And I just wanted to read just a couple of little bits which show this trick, you know, that Remedios floats up to heaven, that the line of blood finds its way through the streets of Macondo to the feet of the mother of the dead man. These things are completely naturalistic. In the Autumn of the Patriarch, when the dictator sells the sea and the Americans come and take away the Caribbean in numbered lots, you know, that's all perfectly comprehensible. But there's a moment in 100 Years of Solitude when a woman who was washing clothes in the river during the hottest time of the day ran screaming down the main street in an alarming state of commotion. "It's coming," she finally explained. "Something frightful, like a kitchen dragging a village behind it." And that's the arrival of the first railway train. in Macondo. And that is something genuinely terrifying and bizarre. This is a strategy which we all can recognize from the very famous opening sentence of the novel. Many years later, as he faced the firing squad, Colonel Aureliano Buendia was to remember that distant afternoon when his father took him to discover ice. Ice, that amazing technology, the freezing of water, is a fabulous thing and is responded to in that way. And of course, the patriarch, José Arcadio, becomes obsessed with the inventions which the gypsies bring to town. And finally, after falling into a kind of frenzy of thought, which abstracts him from the world, one Tuesday in December at lunchtime, all at once he released the whole weight of his torment. The children would remember for the rest of their lives the august solemnity with which their father, devastated by his prolonged vigil and by the wrath of his imagination, revealed his discovery to them. The earth is round, like an orange. Ursula lost her patience. "If you have to go crazy, please go crazy all by yourself," she shouted. "But don't try to put your gypsy ideas into the heads of the children." Thank you, García Márquez, for this great work, and thank you all for listening.
Good evening. I am Jaime Abello. I have written some words for tonight's special event. And although I would have liked to deliver them in English, I think that in a tribute to Gabriel García Márquez, I would not want to mistreat Shakespeare language. I am also sure that my friend Patricia will properly convey them to you. Hace 10 años, yo era el director del canal de televisión pública Telecaribe, cuando recibí una llamada telefónica sorprendente. "¿Me invitas a comer?" fue la pregunta que me hizo nadie menos que Gabriel García Márquez. "Claro que sí, Gabito", le contesté con perplejidad, llamándole por el apodo que prefieren usar sus familiares y sus amigos de Barranquilla. "Yo ando por Cartagena, veámonos el 28 a las 9, tú dirás dónde". Colgué el teléfono sin saber que empezaría una nueva etapa de mi vida. Poco tiempo después, el 28 de diciembre de 1993, Día de los Santos Inocentes en el calendario católico, estábamos reunidos con Mercedes y un grupo de amigos de Barranquilla en un sitio de buena gastronomía con un nombre apropiado para invitar a un premio Nobel, el Club ABC, que es la sigla de las palabras Arte, Belleza, Cultura. Antes había estado con García Márquez de manera casual, pero solo hasta esa noche inolvidable empecé realmente a conocerlo. Entre whiskies, el maestro contó anécdotas de su iniciación como reportero en el periódico El Universal de Cartagena, donde su primer editor, Clemente Manuel Zavala, corregía sus textos con un lápiz rojo. Recordó las parrandas y lecturas con sus hermanos literarios de Barranquilla cuando era periodista de El Heraldo. Al sentarnos a la mesa, manifestó su preocupación por la pesadez teórica de las escuelas de comunicación y su temor con los entrevistadores que confían más en el loro mecánico de la grabadora que en su propia memoria. Ya era la madrugada cuando proclamó su convicción de que el reportaje es un género literario y de que eran necesarios unos talleres en los que veteranos del periodismo discutieran con jóvenes reporteros sobre la carpintería del oficio. "¿Y qué se podría hacer?", le pregunté con algo de ingenuidad. "Piensa en eso", fue todo lo que me dijo con la fuerza de un mandato cuando lo dejé en el hotel. 3 meses más tarde me lo encontré en Cartagena en la inauguración del Festival de Cine. Y lo primero que me dice es: "Ajá, ¿y qué has pensado?", como el profesor que exige una tarea. "Me he reunido con algunos colegas y tengo algunas ideas", le respondí. "Entonces", me dice, "te espero pasado mañana a las 5 en mi apartamento del Laguito". Al día siguiente viajé temprano a Barranquilla, a mi oficina, para prepararle un documento. Eran lo que hoy llamamos, la gente de la fundación, las 2 hojitas. Cuando se las leí, dijo: "Esto es lo que hay que hacer".
Poco a poco empezamos a tejer la red de apoyo del proyecto o de complicidades, como el mismo Gabo prefiere decir. Se hizo un estudio de factibilidad, reuniones de consulta con un grupo de periodistas encabezado por Tomás Eloy Martínez, un gran escritor argentino que ha iniciado tantos buenos periódicos malogrados por causas no periodísticas como novelas memorables. Un año después, en abril del 95, Alma Guillermo Prieto, la gran periodista de The New Yorker, dirigió el primer taller de crónica con un grupo de 10 reporteros menores de 30 años. Desde esa fecha hasta octubre del 2003, la Fundación ha ofrecido 151 talleres y seminarios en 33 ciudades del continente bajo la dirección de 61 maestros de América y Europa, con la participación de casi 2.500 periodistas de todos y cada uno de los países de América Latina. Las premisas que orientan la misión pedagógica de la Fundación han sido planteadas por Gabo con simplicidad aritmética. Un factor esencial en la defensa de la integridad de un periodista, de su independencia y hasta de su vida, es una buena formación profesional. El mejor método para esa formación es el de talleres prácticos en pequeños grupos, con un aprovechamiento crítico de las experiencias históricas y en su marco original de servicio público. En periodismo, la ética es inseparable de la técnica, como el zumbido del moscardón. Es por esto que la Fundación no entrega diplomas ni certificados. La vida se encargará de decir quién sirve y quién no sirve, fue el argumento de Gabo cuando propuso esta medida insólita para sociedades acostumbradas a esconder la mediocridad detrás de un cartón firmado. Varios de los talleres y seminarios de la Fundación han sido dirigidos por el mismo Gabo, no como lo haría un catedrático, sino simplemente como el primero entre iguales. La verdad es que él evita sistemáticamente las conferencias, los congresos y, por qué no decirlo, los homenajes. En cambio, los talleres con colegas principiantes lo divierten como un juego y lo estimulan como una aventura inédita. El amor de García Márquez por el periodismo es uno de los más publicitados del mundo. Muchos piensan que se trata de pura nostalgia, que fue una etapa inicial de su formación de escritor. Yo creo, en cambio, que nunca ha salido de esa etapa. Siente, absorbe y produce como reportero. Lo delatan la actitud siempre atenta, la curiosidad por los detalles, la pasión por informarse y por hablar de periodismo, el modo de investigar para elaborar su escritura. Ha sido un enorme privilegio para mí haber acompañado a García Márquez en este trabajo tan hermoso y haber recibido el don de su amistad y del acceso a su intimidad. Una de las claves para el buen manejo de nuestra relación es que nunca he pretendido ser su vocero. Sin embargo, en esta noche tan especial puedo hablar en nombre de él y del equipo de colaboradores de la Fundación para aprovechar la ocasión y agradecer a todas las personas e instituciones que a lo largo de estos años nos han apoyado para cumplir la misión de promover el buen periodismo y estimular la vocación de los jóvenes periodistas de América Latina. Quiero hacer una mención especial al grupo de talentosos periodistas norteamericanos que año tras año suspenden su trabajo habitual para viajar desde Nueva York, California o Afganistán a Cartagena, Buenos Aires, México o cualquier otra ciudad donde se haga un taller para compartir con entusiasmo su valiosa experiencia con sus colegas de América Latina. Agradezco también al Pen Club y en particular a Esther Allen por incluir a la Fundación en este homenaje como una especie de obra viva de Gabriel García Márquez. Hace dos meses, Gabo y yo estuvimos en Monterrey, México, con motivo de la entrega del Premio Nuevo Periodismo que organizamos conjuntamente con CEMEX, que es un generoso patrocinador de la Fundación. Habían sido unas jornadas intensas con un seminario sobre ética, calidad y empresa periodística y una bella ceremonia con periodistas de todas las edades y de 7 países que recibieron sus premios. Hubo hasta escapadas nocturnas en las que Gabo y Mercedes bailaron salsa y vallenatos en México con el mismo sabor que lo hacen en el Caribe colombiano. Al final de esa semana nos reunimos para conversar sobre los programas de la Fundación con su hermano Jaime. Jamás olvidaré el brillo de sus ojos cuando dijo, y pensar que todo esto estaba en nuestra imaginación. Gracias.
These are Jaime Abello's wonderful words. 10 years ago, I was the head of a television channel. It was the public television called Telecaribe, when I received a surprising phone call. "Would you invite me to dinner?" was the question that no less than García Márquez made me. "Of course, Gabito," I answered, perplexed, calling him by the nickname that his family and his Barranquilla friends use. "Okay, I'm around Cartagena. Let's see each other around the 28th at 9. You say where." I hung up, and I didn't know I was starting a new chapter in my life. Short time later, the 28th of December of 1993, the day of the innocent saints in the Catholic calendar, we were together with Mercedes and a group of Barranquilla friends in a very good eating place with a very appropriate name to invite a Nobel Prize to dinner, the ABC Club, which stands for Art, Beauty, and Culture. I had been with García Márquez in a casual way, but it was only that night when I really unforgettably began to know him. Between whiskeys, the maestro told us anecdotes of his initiation as a young reporter in the El Universal of Cartagena, where his first editor, Clemente Manuel Zavala, would correct his text with a red pencil. He remembered the parting and the chats with his literary band of brothers in Barranquilla when he was a journalist of El Heraldo. And when we sat down at the table, he said he was concerned because he thought the communication schools were just very heavy laden with theory, and his fear that the young reporters and interviewers trusted more the mechanical parrot of the tape recorder than their own memory and instincts. It was already dawn when he said that reporting is a literary genre in itself, and it was necessary to maybe have some workshops where old masters would teach the young beginning journalists the carpentry of the job. "What can we do?" I asked him, somewhat naively. "Well, think about it," he said, and it had the strength of a mandate when I left him at the hotel. 3 months later, I found him again. I ran into him at the inauguration of the Cartagena Film Festival. "So what have you thought?" he said, asking you as the teacher who demands to know whether you've completed the homework. "Well, you know, I met with a couple of colleagues and I have a few ideas," I said. "Well, then I will see you the day after tomorrow at 5 in my apartment in El Laguito." The next day, I traveled very early to Barranquilla to prepare some kind of document to bring to the meeting. And they were what today we call the two little pages, which was the beginning of the foundation. He read them, and he said, "This is what we have to do." Little by little, we started to knit the network of support for this project, or of complicities, which is his preferred word. We did feasibility studies, we did consulting meetings with groups of journalists headed by the Argentine Tomás Eloy Martínez. A little bit later, in April of 95, Alma Guillermo Prieto, the great journalist for The New Yorker, ran the first workshop. It was called Chronicles, with a group of 10 reporters, all younger than 30. Since then, until October of 2003, the foundation has given 151 workshops and seminars in 33 cities of the continent under the direction of 61 teachers from America and Europe, with the participation of almost 2,500 journalists from every country in Latin America. The educational mission of the foundation has been set out by Gabo with a real mathematical simplicity: the defense of the integrity of a journalist, of his independence, and even of their lives. Good professional foundation, the best method for this being very small workshops in very small groups, in taking advantage of the historical experience and the original framework of service to the public. Journalism, he believes the ethic is indivisible from technique, as the buzzing of the fly. This is why we in the foundation do not grant diplomas or certificates. Life will take care of deciding who's good and who isn't, was García Márquez's argument when he proposed this very unusual measure in our societies who are accustomed to hide mediocrity behind a piece of cardboard. Lots of the workshops and seminars of the foundation have been run by Gabo himself, not as a professor, but simply as the first among equals. The truth is that he systematically avoids conferences, congresses, and tributes. But in the workshops with his beginner colleagues, he has fun, it's a game, and he's stimulated in this adventure. His love for journalism is very well publicized. Lots of people think it's really nostalgia because it was the first stage of his work as a writer. But I think he's never really left this stage. He feels, he absorbs, he produces like a reporter. His attitude is always attentive. He's curious about every detail. He's passionate about information and journalism, the way you investigate to write something up. It has been a great privilege to have been with García Márquez in this beautiful job and have been benefited from the gift of his friendship. One of the keys for the good management of our relationship is I have never pretended to be his spokesman. Nevertheless, in this very special night, I could say in his name and of the foundation and collaborators and all of the team to take advantage of this occasion and thank every person and every institution that throughout these years have supported us to carry out the mission of promoting good journalism and stimulating and supporting young journalists. I want to make a special mention of the group of very talented North American journalists that year after year have suspended their daily work to travel from New York, California, or Afghanistan to Cartagena, Buenos Aires, Mexico, and other cities to share with enthusiasm their valuable experience with the young colleagues in Latin America. I'm also grateful to the Penn Club, and in particular to Esther Allen, for including the foundation in this tribute. It's a kind of living work of García Márquez. 2 months ago, we were in Mexico, in Monterrey with Gabo, because we were giving out the new journalism prizes that we organized with CEMEX, who's a generous sponsor of the foundation. There were very intense days, seminars on ethics, quality, the business of journalism, and a beautiful ceremony with journalists of every age and from 7 countries that received their first prizes. There were even nocturnal escapades where Gabo and Mercedes danced salsa and vallenato in Mexico with the same flavor that they do in the Caribbean. At the end, we got together to talk about the programs and the foundation with his brother Jaime. And I will never forget the spark in his eyes when he said, and to think that all of this was in our imagination. And to end the evening, I have a message from García Márquez for all of you. I will first read his original in Spanish and then my version in English. Gracias por acordarse de mí en estos tiempos de olvidos y por enaltecer mi obra con un reconocimiento que me honra y me conmueve. Por desgracia, desde que tengo memoria, el mundo no fue nunca menos propicio que hoy para celebraciones de júbilo y efemérides de gloria. Más grave que los cataclismos y las guerras innumerables que han acosado al género humano desde siempre, es ahora la certidumbre de que los grandes poderes económicos, políticos y militares de estos malos tiempos parecen concertados para arrastrarnos por los intereses más mezquinos y con las armas terminales hacia un mundo de desigualdades insolvables. Contra ellos, que son dueños de todo, no quedan más poderes que los de la razón, con las armas de la inteligencia y la palabra, que por fortuna son las nuestras, para inducirlos al último minuto de reflexión que hace falta para salvar el mundo. you for remembering me in these times of forgetting, and for distinguishing my work with a recognition that both honors and moves me. Unfortunately, I cannot remember a less appropriate time for jubilant celebration and for days of glory than today. Graver than the cataclysms and innumerable wars that have plagued the human race forever is now the certainty that the great economic, political, and military powers of these evil times seem to be conspiring to drag us out of the most petty interest and with the ultimate weapons towards a world of insurmountable inequalities. Against those who own everything, no power remains to us but those of reason, intelligence, and language, which fortunately are ours, to lead them to that last moment of reflection that is needed to save the world. Thank you.